We talked about negotiation as the first of the skills of leadership. We moved from there to administration. Can somebody tell me what administration meant in the context we gave it in terms of the verses that we were applying it to, verses 7 and 8 of chapter 2? What is the idea of administration the way we were using the term? Having a plan, being specific, measurable, what else? Focus on the essential needs, keep first things first. These are absolutely required of good leaders. Let me move to number 3, which is in verses 9 and 10, and that is perception. Perception. This is consideration of the probable opposition. Perception is, ladies, when you park, you need perception. You get out of a dark parking lot, you need to know what's all around you. You don't need to know where the door is, where the bushes are. You need a perception of what's around you. I'm serious. I'm not fooling around here. You need to be aware, if you park in a place that is isolated and dark around the back of a building by yourselves, you are putting yourself in peril. You need perception of what the opposition would be. You need to think through quickly, what am I going to be doing here? How do I get in and out safely? Remember that when you pull in and it's afternoon, if you're coming out in the dark, what will this be? Put it under a light. Oh yeah, but it'll get my car hot. Yes, but that will be a much better alternative than being in a dark place. Perception is a leadership quality. And I keep finding people that want to lead but don't perceive the opposition points. I say this often. If I were the enemy, this is how I'd go after me this week. That's perception. You all learned it as defensive driving. When you're driving, you pay attention not just to what you're doing, but what everybody around you is doing. Pay attention to the reality that there is opposition in everything God will call you to do, because God is doing it and the enemy hates it. So, verses 9 and 10. This is the third skill, and it's no less important. It says, as the journal continues in verse 9, "Then I came to the governors of the provinces beyond the river and gave them the king's letters. Now the king had sent me with officers of the army and horsemen. When Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite official heard about it, it was very displeasing to them that someone had come to seek the welfare of the sons of Israel." Did you notice the two rules of perception in the verses? Did you see them? First, Nehemiah aimed his perception skills at assessing the threat. He knew what the threat level was for the situation. For a man who's buffing wax on a car, a single grain of sand on the buffing pad can tear the paint apart. If you put a single grain of sand in a buffing pad and you go out there like this, you will cut into the paint a single grain of sand. For an accountant, a single misdirected entry when put into the system can take hours of searching for a balance. For a leader, it's essential to look in the direction of anything that could slow or cripple the work and find a way to close the breach if you can. Part of the perception ability is to look out there and say, what do you think the enemy will attack? Let me give you this as a sidebar. Watch those who are emotionally weak. They will often be the place where the enemy will attack. The second part of this, I think I'm kind of interested. The second thing Nehemiah did was specifically knew who the opponents were as they reacted to the letter that they received. There's an old world management line. It shows up on a number of posters. The breakfast of champions is not cereal, it's the opposition. If you're going to win, you're going to have to take them down. And to take them down, you're going to have to understand he had a deadline, he knew where the opposition was coming from, and he was going to do nothing to let them win. I want you to be gracious, I want you to be tender, but when somebody's opposing God's work, I want you to be tenacious and tough. I don't want nice Marines. I don't want them to go over with flowers. They're Marines. Take the ground. Do what you're called to do. If someone walks in the door, excited and upset because we're doing what God called us to do, I will stop them. Why? Because it's necessary. More often than I can tell you, I've had people come unglued because they just feel like, I can't believe that you're telling me I'm a sinner. I didn't. The Bible did. I'm here to tell you what it says. You would be absolutely blown away by the number of people who will take things that you take for granted from the Bible and be upset that we vocalize them. It's okay. They didn't like when Jesus said it either, and I'm not Jesus. So I'm just figuring it comes with it. Look, know where your opposition is coming from. I want you to even make that personal. If you're struggling with certain thoughts, ask yourself, where am I when they occur? Create a situational backdrop to change the environment. If you're struggling with a certain person, maybe when you get together with them, they draw you into gossip and you find yourself sinning because you're with them, then figure out how you can maneuver around that because you're not only opposing them, you're opposing you. In other words, sometimes you're your own worst enemy, and sometimes you have to set up yourself so that you can't hinder you from God's call in your life. And so I would emphasize that opposition comes in a lot of different ways. I think that other people who oppose what God is doing often feel like their cause has more support than it actually does. Let me say it this way. If God calls you to do something, then God's invested in it. That means that the opposition to it is not as strong as it thinks it is. I believe that Satan thinks he's equal to God. He's not. I just think he thinks he is. I think that people come in with their own understanding of what they think your ministry ought to be. But if you have a call from God, you already know what it is. So let me go to the next one, because this one may help you. I hope the others help you as well. But number four in verses 11 to 15, number four is inspection. Inspection. Expect only what you consistently inspect. Expect only what you consistently inspect. As you keep reading, read Nehemiah 2:11. So I came to Jerusalem, and there I was there 3 days. I arose in the night, I and a few men with me. I did not tell anyone what God was putting into my mind to do for Jerusalem, and there was no animal with me except the animal on which I was riding. So I went out at night by the valley gate in the direction of the dragon's well and on to the refuse gate, inspecting the walls of Jerusalem which were broken down and its gates which were consumed by fire. Then I passed on to the fountain gate and the king's pool, and there was no place for my mount to pass. So I went up at night by the ravine and inspected the wall. Then I entered the valley gate and again and returned. What is he saying? Nehemiah didn't let information get out ahead of time. He allowed God to work in him and work out the plan without saying it to everyone. Why was that smart? When King Hussein first became king of Jordan, he knew that there was in Aqaba, in the port of Jordan, a number of people who were cheating. They were cheating on port taxes. There was a known corruption going on at the port. So he made an announcement that on Tuesday the king would visit. And on Monday, a little old woman was sitting at the door just as the port was doing its business. And that little old lady was King Hussein, dressed as a little old woman. She watched everything that happened so that he, as king, could come in the next day and say, this is a picture of me yesterday. I was sitting right there. Now let's talk about what I'm seeing. If you announce an inspection, it's not a pop inspection. If you tell them the quiz is coming, then it's not really an assessment of what they know. It's an assessment of what they can study. Okay? So what he does is Nehemiah decides that he doesn't want to get his information secondhand. Listen to me carefully. One of the dangers of leadership is the further up the pole you go, the further you will be from the actual event, which means people will filter what you hear about it. This is the problem that our president has, because you might hear more about what actually happened than he does. He's in a room and he only hears what he hears. He only gets the filtered version. Now, I hope his version is better than the one I get. I hope. But if it's not, he's going to make the wrong decision, and it's not because he's a bad person, it's because he doesn't have the right information. You do what you can with the information you have, okay? I want you to notice in verse 11 that they were completely unexpected. If you want to see it the way it is, then don't get them to dress up first. Just see it the way it is. In verse 12, the plan was completely undisclosed. People will color the plan with their own shading if they know what the plan is. Many leaders are too quick to take a work God is developing within them and give it out into the path of traffic. God may lay on your heart a way to do something in your call. Don't throw it out there too quickly. Sit on it. Think about it. Allow God to use it. Did you notice what he said? I did not tell anyone what God was putting into my mind. He was confident that God was leading him, but he didn't talk about it. Some leaders, everything that comes into their mind comes out their mouth. Wait, give it time. And then it says they were unparaded. It's interesting. Absalom traveled with an entourage of 50 men of Judah running beside him. This guy traveled with the smallest complement he possibly could in the middle of the night, because the substance of the plan was dependent upon it not being a show. So leaders can polish their buttons and admire themselves in the mirror, or they can go out and get the work done. You've got to decide, what are you trying to do? You trying to look like a better leader or be a better leader? Now, inspection. Does everybody understand what he did? He goes out in the middle of the night, he walks around the walls, and he sees for himself the condition. Why does he do it in the middle of the night? Because he doesn't want anyone to know the full assessment of what it is he's doing. It's harder to do at night. Couldn't he get a better view in the daytime? Yes, but then everybody would know what it was he was doing, including his opposition. In the middle of the night, he's doing an assessment because he doesn't want to stop and go, wow, that's a real weak point in the wall, because the opposition has eyes and ears everywhere. He's just quietly doing what he's doing, and he keeps on doing it. He's inspecting, but he's not yet reacting. Get down to verse 16. The next one, number 5, is discretion. Discretion is telling your plans only when you're sure of what they are. I mentioned the fact that his journal makes clear that Nehemiah did not share things quickly, and that's a good creative leadership. But look at verse 16. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I had done, nor had I as yet told the Jews, the priests, the nobles, the officials, or the rest who did the work. I want you to see that what he does is he holds back and he uses a level of discretion about when and where to say what. Let me just say it this way. As a leader, you're going to know a lot of things followers don't know, and even other leaders may not know what you know, and that's okay. Don't give away everything about everything. By the way, this is one of the biggest problems we have with parenting today. Parents who want to be friends with their kids tell their kids too much. Your kids don't need to know everything that's going on. And by the way, they don't belong in your marriage. Your children don't belong in your marriage. They don't belong in your marriage. If you're wondering, they don't belong in your marriage. You don't get your kids to side with you. This is not a democracy, okay? It's a marriage. So the two of you work out your issues away from the kids. Discretion is about knowing when to not speak. Bill McCartney retired as the head coach of the Colorado football team several years ago. His reason for retirement was not because he was unsuccessful as a coach. His teams had won the national championship. They had been at the top 10 times. McCartney said that he was retiring because he wanted to reevaluate his priorities. Nobody believed him. He said, I'm leaving coaching. I'm going to take a whole year to reevaluate my priorities. Is God first? Is my family second? Is my work third? And when that year was over, Bill McCartney had dedicated his life and his talents to Christ and threw his efforts into founding the great men's renewal gatherings that came about as Promise Keepers. He became the head of Promise Keepers after a year of taking time off. He could have announced his next move, but he wanted to take the time to evaluate. That's discretion. You think you know you want to make a move. You don't run around and talk about it. Probably 10 times in my pastoral career, I've had to correct men for saying that they think maybe next year God's calling them out of that church, and they told people in that church. When you say, I'm going to jump ship, people who are weak jump. Now, maybe God is telling you, I think this is getting done. I think maybe I'm not going to be here. Shut up. Use some discretion about what God is saying to you and quietly ask him, when is the right time? not only to go, but to make people know that this is what God is going to do. And by the way, when you're the leader of the group, it's not just where you're going, it's where they're going. You have both agendas. So you have to say, how is my departure here going to affect them? Let me give you the sixth one. It's presentation. Do not lack in the presentation area. Packaging the idea properly is essential to successful management. Look at verses 17 and 18. Oh, the packaging. Many leaders drop the ball on presentation. And when you present plans, you want to inspire people. But look at what he says in verse 17. Then I said to them, you see the bad situation we are in, that Jerusalem is desolate and its gates are burned with fire. Now stop right there. He starts off with the problem. You could end on the problem. Oh, things are bad. And you could just leave everybody with this great gift of depression. I just want you to know, brothers, we are dying. Do you know how many guys are doing that? Seriously? They're walking into their ministry saying, just nobody cares anymore. Seriously? Now, notice that he doesn't walk in and say, I have the solution. He says, come, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem so that we will no longer be a reproach. I'm asking you to join me in the pursuit that is going to happen. By the way, I got letters, I got supplies, I got the king behind me. I'm not just showing up with a great idea. I got a tank of gas and a good car, okay? We got something we can do it with. I told them how the hand of my God had been favorable to me and also about the king's words which he had spoken to me. Then they said, let us arise and build. So they put their hands to do the good work. Do you notice that he had been there and he inspected before he told them what he was doing? He told the governors of the lands he passed through what he was doing, but the people locally on the scene didn't understand that he was coming back to solve the problem. They were still sitting there in the problem. He walks in with an idea of how to do it, but he walks in also with the assets in play. Note that it's not just what he said, but how he said it that made a difference. Nehemiah personalized the problem of the people. He didn't say, you know, you guys have a rotten city here. This place is pretty busted up. He said, I'm one of you. We together will rise up and rebuild. He made himself part. Listen, if you come in from the outside as the leader and you don't make yourself part of the group, they will not accept that they are part of the solution. They will look at it like, you want it, you fix it. And they will let you fix it. And in ministry after ministry, there are people out there who are like one-man bands doing everything. Instead of equipping the believers to do the work of the ministry, they're doing it for them, and it's because the people didn't buy in. I have one thing to say to my brothers and sisters in church leadership. Stop worrying about how to get more people into your church and start serving the ones you got. Rather than turn your full heart and your attention into a relentless passion to follow the Savior in every pursuit of the day ahead, we go running off trying to figure out how to make a better name for ourselves, and that's not what God is in. The church needs the presentation of a call to greatness. Every ministry you're going to do, your kids need a call to greatness. I don't want you to fill them up with a whole bunch of empty air, but I want you to let them know that God working in them can change a generation. Don't ever believe that a small number of people utterly dedicated to God can't make a difference, because it's the only thing that ever did. It's the only thing that ever did. Okay, go down to number 7, because this is going to begin the next section of our series. And number 7 is conflict management. Conflict management. Whenever you are moving ahead for God, there will be conflict. Opposition will always follow a real leader. What differentiates the good ones is how they handle it, but it will come. So verse 19, when Sanballat the Horonite and Tuvia the Ammonite official and Geshem the Arab heard it, they mocked us. They despised us and said, what is this thing you're doing? Are you rebelling against the king? So I answered them and said this, the God of heaven will give us success. Therefore, we, his servants, will arise and build. You have no portion, right, or memorial in Jerusalem. I love this. This is a great response. This always makes me smile. Nehemiah did two things that I wish I could do consistently. The first thing he did was he listened carefully for the motivation behind their words. He knew the words were a cover for a deep-seated set of fears and negative feelings. And the second thing is, he answered them. He was brief, he was polite, but he was clear. He didn't placate them with falsehoods, nor did he waste hours on empty accusations. He simply said, God's at work, and he's not going to be stopped by you or anybody else. We're going to do this building because that's what God told me to do, and your participation was neither requested nor required. Okay? Love and kisses, Nehemiah. Thank you, your concerned neighbor. Now please walk on so we can do what we're here to do. You'd be surprised at what can happen if you'll look right at the face of the one who threatens the work of God, and you don't get rude, but you don't flinch. You want to play chicken? Don't play chicken over God's work. When God calls you to do it, God called you to do it. And when somebody's coming along and they're going to be all against what God called you to do, you're going to have to look without flinching. Don't be rude, but don't acquiesce to the enemy. God hasn't left us to lead without a pattern. So I think chapter 2 gives this really good pattern. I want to close this with something. Chuck Colson wrote shortly before he died, he said, over recent months, I've taught worldview to groups of bright young students. With each group, I had the same distressing experience when I presented a classic example of a self-refuting moral proposition. They didn't get it. An example, the late Christopher Reeve in his wheelchair with a breathing tube was testifying before a Senate committee. Reeve dismissed moral objections to embryonic stem cell research, claiming that the purpose of government is to serve the greatest good for the greatest number. I then asked the students, what's wrong with that picture? I got no answer, so I dropped heavy hints. Only one student gave the correct answer. If what Reeve advocated actually were a governing philosophy, he would not have been there to testify. Who would spend millions to keep him alive when that money could have been spent on thousands? Christopher Reeve was an actor. He played Superman. He got hurt in a horse accident. Millions of dollars were spent to save his life. He's there with this breathing tube, and he's saying, you know what? We got to use the money to help the most people we can. Look at the irony of that. He wouldn't be there. He said, I don't know whether the students lacked analytical skills or were just confused, but when I explained the inherent contradiction, the light went on. When I discussed the concept of absolute truth and the fact that absolute truth is knowable, there was an occasional nod of understanding, but it was clear as I was breaking new ground for most of the students. These students, mind you, were products of Christian homes and schools. This lack of worldview awareness is appalling, but it's exactly what George Barna found when he was doing his recent polls. Just 9% of evangelical students believe in anything called absolute truth. What does that say about the job our schools, families, and our churches are doing? Here's the bottom line. You're spending a year to learn truths, and most people don't even believe there are any. They believe it's all relative. And here's the strange part. You're gonna go out in just a matter of months and be in a different classroom setting or different ministry setting with different people around you, and you're going to find that they will fight you over the notion of the most basic truths of the Bible. And some of those will be your Christian friends. And you're going, what are you doing here? Why are you here? Why are you preaching a gospel when there's not absolute truth? I'm not trying to paint a darker picture. I'm trying to say you plus God will walk into the room, but you've got to know what you're walking into. The opposition is there, and often it's friendly fire you're dying from. It's not the unbelievers. It's the other believers sniping at you. What's interesting to me is the number of believers that will take the time to criticize other believers publicly, but spend no time actually criticizing what's going on in our world or critiquing it in any practical way. So they'll go on and look at YouTubes of other believers and say all the things that they disagreed with theologically, rather than go on to all the lost people and try to share Christ. Because what we need to do is get in front of our team and tell everybody about how we're all different. Because that's going to do what? Leave people lost. The enemy is working, not primarily by deception, but by deceiving through the over-information that is existing in our world. Honestly, read your cell phone bill. Tell me if you can figure out what it means. I have a PhD and I don't know. 12 to 24 pages a month and you won't know what it means. Here's my point. The enemy's not just lying. He's lying in 52 lines of what you get, but you can't even hardly find it. And somehow that's okay. And literally, people are walking around with so much information, they have no way to manage it. It feels in modernity like life is becoming more complicated. This is supposed to make it more simple. It has one button, only one, the holy fruit of Cupertino. Has only one button. It's supposed to work very simply, right? It takes my thumbprint and it opens on my thumbprint. Isn't that wonderful? It's here's what happened though. Actually, more and more is being compacted into something and I don't know how it works. So that now, if your car breaks down, it's a mystery. If your phone doesn't work, it's a mystery. If your computer shuts off, it's a mystery. It's all so complicated, it's beyond us. So we walk around like sheep. Oh, this is the new way it works? And what happens is, people can introduce any kind of principles they want to a society that's utterly blind about how things get done. I want you to be careful. Now, we're going to start in chapter 3 with a punishing group of trials that come up against Nehemiah. He hasn't just gotten started yet. You get to chapter 3 and it just starts getting fun. And I got to tell you, the first one, chapter 3, was one of the hardest chapters in the Bible for me to ever preach in my career. It's probably the single hardest one. You know why? Do you know what's in chapter 3? Look at chapter 3 for a minute. I'm just going to read a few verses to enlighten you, okay? 3:1, Eliashib the high priest arose with his brothers, the priests, and built the sheep gate. They consecrated it and hung its doors. They consecrated the wall of the Tower of the Hundred and the Tower of Hananel. Next to him, the men of Jericho built, and next to them, Zachor, the son of Imri, built. Now the sons of Hasenah built the fish gate. They laid its beams and hung its doors with its bolts and bars. Next to them, Merimoth, the son of Uriah, the son of Hakoz, made repairs. Next to him, Meshulam, the son of Berechiah, the son of Meshizabel, made repairs. And next to him, Zedek, the son of Baanah, also made repairs. Moreover, next to him, the Tekoaites made repairs. But their nobles did not support the work of their masters. If you get to Saturday night and start preparing this one, you're toast for Sunday morning. This is one long list of who built what. It's not a bad list. This is a fabulous chapter. But it took me about a month to figure out what to do with it. This is principles of people work. This is how you get team building 101 to work. And I got to tell you, you will not find a passage in the Bible harder to teach than this one. However, it's great. The problem is you got to let it soak until you get what he's trying to say. This is how people work together. This is how to build an effective team to accomplish something God told them to do. Now, don't forget the premise of chapter 3 is God told them to do this. If God didn't tell you to do it, then nothing I'm going to say is going to work, okay? This is God's work. John Maxwell is a sort of a go-to guru on leadership and Christian circles. He made a living for years sharing principles of management and leadership and development. And when you look into Nehemiah, the Spirit directed an ancient journal of a leader, Nehemiah. And I thought maybe sharing an anecdote about the meaning of life from John would be appropriate because it'll help you to smile a little bit about what this is about. He says, I turned 65 this year and my dad just turned 91. With this reflective time, I want to offer something that explains life a little better. We will ask questions about life and how we fit in and what our purpose is. Here's my explanation. On the first day, God created the dog. God said, sit all day at the door of your house and bark at anybody that comes by. I will give you a lifespan of 20 years. The dog replied, that's too long to be barking. Give me 10 years and I will give you back 10 of those years. And God agreed. On the second day, God created a monkey. God said, entertain people, do monkey tricks. I will give you a 20-year lifespan. The monkey replied, how boring. I am to do monkey tricks for 20 years? The dog gave you back 10 years, so I think I would like to use only 10 years and give you back the other 10. God agreed. On the third day, God created a cow. You must go into the field, stand in the hot sun, bear calves, and give milk to the farmer. I'm going to give you a lifespan of 60 years. The cow, picking up on the dog and the monkey, said to the Lord, "That's kind of a tough life. If you want me to live 60 years, let me have 20 and I'll give you back the other 40. God agreed. On the fourth day, God created man. He said, "You are to eat, sleep, play, marry, and enjoy your life. I will give you 20 years. The man replied, "What? Only 20 years? I'll tell you what. I'm going to take the 10 years of the dog that he gave you back, the 10 years of the monkey that he gave you back, and 40 years of the cow that he gave you back, and that makes 80 years. And the Lord said, okay, you got a deal. That, my friends, is why the first 20 years of our lives, we eat, sleep, play, marry, and enjoy our lives. For the next 40 years, we stand in the sun, support our family around us. The next 10 years, we grab the grandchildren and do monkey tricks to make them laugh. And the last 10 years, we sit on the porch at our homes and bark at everybody who goes by. Now, I thought that his explanation of life was insightful. And I laughed at his explanation, but not only because it was humorous, but because it contained some truth. One of the things that we do is we pass negativity too easily to our kin. Even in the faith, we pass negativity too easily to our kin. So I want you to, are there any good biblical texts that build a rabble into a team of performers? Yes, there are. Let me put this over chapter 3. The key to progress is consistently doing the right things the right way. The key to progress is consistently doing the right things the right way. Now, what's the right thing? What God called you to do. What's the right way? How God told you to do it. So when you look back, you see in chapter 1, there was a burden behind it. And in chapter 2, there was a plan behind it. And by the end of chapter 2, there was opposition that confronted it, right? So you get to chapter 3, and you start looking, and now we're actually building. Oh, wait. If you thought what the what they were doing before was going to raise the hackles of the enemy, it didn't get going until this started. Now the buildings, now the budgets, now the bands. It takes people. There's no greater way to impact them than intentionally establish and carefully maintain relationships. So look what happens. I can read through 32 long verses of names. Eliashiv, Hananel, Hasanaah, Zakor, Imri, Oriah, Hakoz, Meshizabel, Tzadok, Ba'ana, Yehoida. You get the idea. I can read you all these familiar and unfamiliar names, and you'll just sit there and go, why in the world would God give me 32 verses of who built what? Well, here's what I want you to see. First, go to verse 1. And when you look at verse 1, it says, Eliashiv the high priest arose with his brothers the priests and built the sheep gate. They consecrated, hung the doors. They consecrated the wall to the tower of the 100 and to the tower of Hananiel. The very first thing that I read is that the leadership invested first and then the people joined. This is spiritual leader. High priest got up and started building. The leader invests first. That's what gets people on board. In the case of the work of God, that started with the high priest. And the first thing we notice is that sweat and godliness go hand in hand. I wish someone would have told me that in Bible college. Sweat and godliness. Work should begin with godly leadership that's willing to work hard to accomplish what God called the team to do. They're part of a team. They're not above the team. They're part of the team. You can't lead people until they feel like you're part of them. Now, my work as a teacher, if I do my work well, you're going to hear things that are challenging and engaging. And yet, when you search the scriptures on your own, and you are called to search the scriptures on your own, you should find my words faithful to the principles of the master's words. If that's not true, then I'm failing as a teacher. Doesn't matter how well I craft my words, it's still a failure. Pastor Matt's work is primarily as a manager. He can preach and he can teach and he does things. He counsels people from the Word of God. But primarily, he's called to manage people and to make sure that things are properly maintained and that the staff is doing their respective ministry works and that there's a functioning team. He is also privately and intentionally making disciples. He's got people over his house. He's doing all that. That's a couple of examples. But here's the thing. I haven't gotten to many of the people in our ministry. I don't know what JoJo does. I can't do what she does. It would make me crazy to sit there and I can't do that. And the people that call and the many plates that she's, I can't do all that. You're not called to do it all. You're called to find the team and then be a part of the team. Interestingly enough, beyond the fact that God calls the work a work, just notice the work is part of worship. The initial focus of the wall was at what part? What's the first part of the wall that is mentioned in verse 1? Sheep gate. That's where the sheep go in, get washed, and taken to the temple to deal with atonement. The first part of the wall dealt with worship. What's interesting is churches can swell in numbers, but the size only matters if the people are in the Word and on their knees. They have to grow in dependence and surrender to an awesome God, or they're going to be, it's just going to be numbers. Now, what's interesting to me is if you take a moment, look at the second half of verse 1, notice the second part of the verse. They consecrated it and hung the doors. Wait, whoa, 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 whoa. That's not an idle phrase. What does it mean to consecrate it? You dedicate it, but you dedicate it for a holy purpose. This word consecrate is literally, they knew that the work that they were doing was holy. So they knew that they had to deliberately and biblically set aside it for God's purposes alone. I get somewhat concerned about the familiarity we all have in doing God's work. It's just our kids and our little buildings, and we forget the magnificent God that we're serving here. We forget what we're doing. The children of this place are the heritage of the Lord to us. The hurting woman in the hospital is a precious part of the flock. Everything that we're doing in this ministry, this is God's church. You handle it as something that's precious because it belongs to a majestic Lord. Let me go on and say this. Just another observation at the end of verse 1. They did the most important thing first. They took the most vulnerable part. How do I know? What wall did they build on first? The Tower of the 100 to the Tower of Hananel is the north wall. You're supposed to know enough about the city to know what it is. The north is the part where Jerusalem was most vulnerable. In other words, they started on the most vulnerable part first. That's incredibly important. Look at verse 2. The people of God have to be led by God to get on board and join the work. Look at this. Next to him, the men of Jericho built. Now, underline men of Jericho. Then go down to verse 5. Next to him, the Tekoites made repairs. Did you notice the phrase next to them, over and over? You see the names of people, but in two cases you observe two other towns, Jericho in the Judean wilderness east of Jerusalem, and Tekoa southeast of Bethlehem in the Judean wilderness. Why mention these? Well, first, we have to remember that a burden is the beginning of a ministry, but a team is the vital prerequisite to get a ministry going. In other words, the burden may be the passion behind it, but the team makes it happen, okay? There's a stone and mortar evidence of this story that is irrefutable. They built the wall. I've actually worked along that wall archaeologically. That wall still stands. 52 days they built a wall in Jerusalem and it's still there. Okay? But here's what I noticed that's interesting. Not everybody got the same size project. Now, make a note behind or alongside the verses that we just looked at. Let's say alongside verses 2 through 5, not everybody got the same size. How do I know that? The Tekoaites were given work in verse 4. Now drop down to verse 27. Do you see it again? Somebody look in verse 27. Do you see in verse 20 it says, after them the Tekoaites repaired another section. Underline in verse 27 the word another section. Then make a note next to verse 5 that they show up again and do double the labor of other people. Not everybody does the same amount of work. Some people are more motivated and get twice as much done. In every group of people work you will ever have, it will not be evenly distributed. Listen to me carefully. On the team, there will be people who do more than everybody else on the team. I keep listening to people go, you know, 20% of the people in the church do 80% of the work. 20% of the people in anything do 80% of the work. 20% of the people in a football team do 80% of the work. 20% of the band does 80% of the work. If you think it's evenly distributed, you don't know how teams work. In every place you're going to work, 20% of the workers will do 80% of the work. Most people will clock in. They won't do the full job. Other people will do so much of the job that they're running around making sure everything's happening. And the question is not, is it an 80-20 split? The question is, which part of the percentage are you on? So I want you to know that it is absolutely normal in effective teamwork to see some people doing double labor. And by the way, effective teamwork necessitates people getting over the unfairness of the workloads not being evenly distributed. As long as you've got people going, that's not fair, he's not doing as much as I am, they're wasting your time. Okay, what I need are people that are going to row, not discuss rowing, not discuss how the other guy's rowing isn't as good as their rowing, just row, okay? Honestly, cleaning a toilet. You can get people that will stand there for 10 minutes and talk about cleaning toilet. Just clean the toilet. The bottom line here is that if you're going to, there's always going to be some people that carry inordinate amounts of work, and it's right that they be specifically recognized for doing so. I think it's important that he wrote down what everybody did. See, the leader took note of those who did double duty and made sure everybody knew it. Some of the more prominent towers to build were done by some groups while other people were building along the public latrines. Can I just tell you, the number of people that were volunteering to work along the latrine side of Jerusalem was probably smaller than the ones who were doing the real majestic towers. Everybody likes the part that's cool. But here's the thing, without latrines, people aren't going to be working very long. So the reality is, we have to make a point about those who do the work. If you're a very public leader that cannot take time to join a private prayer circle and cannot take time to affirm the people that are doing the work, you're going to find that your team is going to shrink. The third thing I would tell you is this. My point on that second one was that the people of God have to be led to get on board. The third one is it's essential to recall that not everybody will be convinced of the cause and they won't all be willing to join and pull their own weight. Where do I get that? Look at the second half of verse 5. Their nobles did not support the work of their masters. Don't miss that little nugget right there at the end of verse 5. The truth is, some people will think they're too good to follow the leaders. They'll miss the blessing of God for their labors, and forever settled in heaven is this, the eternal word of the immortal God concerning a small handful of stiff-necked Tekoaite nobles who wouldn't get on board. I love that. Forever in the word of God, it says, these nobles, that day, on that place, wouldn't do their job. So they'll always be remembered as the guys who didn't show up and do their job. You don't want to be on that list, okay? I'm in a lot of places where leaders are trained, and I respect a great many leaders, but I don't respect contentious leaders, and I don't think that they lead very well. And honestly, rather than being on board with what the leaders are doing, they're busy over there as nobles sitting there going, I don't really agree with the way this is being done. There are some people that every time I meet them, they have to explain to me what they don't agree with. I'm not impressed. Okay? Show me what your life's about. I got to tell you, this is one of my problems with college protests. People who have never done anything for the tax base running around telling us how we're all wrong. How about you contribute a little bit and then we'll hear you, okay? Do something with your lives and then we'll talk about it. But everybody's got grand ideas before they have to actually go out and work. Here's the thing. When you get down to verse 6, the fourth one is this. The best team leaders can catch, they can match causes and build coalitions. Let me say it this way. The best team leaders can take this cause over here and match it to a coalition of workers. Some work can be done in conjunction with others and their objectives without buying into all of their ideas. But for the most part, you have to get people to buy you before they buy the work. So watch this in verse 6. Jehoiada, the son of Paseach, and Meshulam, the son of Besodiah, repaired the old gate. They laid its beams, hung its doors with its bolts and its bars. Next to them, Melatiah, the Gibeonite, and Yadon, the Moronathite, the men of Gibeon and of Mizpah, also made repairs for the official seat of the governor of the province beyond the river. Now, here's the thing. Did you notice that the men of Gibeah and Mizpah, that are suburbs of Jerusalem, worked on the repairs and also related repairs to the governor's palace on the other side? So the men were working on the wall, but they had another objective behind that. They also wanted to reestablish the government center, or let's say the county seat, if you will. These are guys in the outlying county that come and they work on the wall, but they also work on the, say, county seat. They saw themselves as working for more than just one objective. So they weren't just working to put a wall around Jerusalem. They were also trying to get their place back up and going. So even though it wasn't their town, it was the county seat for their town. So they came in and did double duty. I think one of the things that happens is this isn't just Nehemiah getting people to build a wall. This is Nehemiah inspiring whole towns of people to come and build a coalition to make this work. And it's not just self-benefit. If you live in Mizpah or you live in Gibeon, you live outside of Jerusalem, but it's worthwhile to have Jerusalem back up and functioning. I think that, go down to verse 9 for a second. I want you to see if you catch this. Next to them, Rephaiah, the son of Hur, the official of the half of the district of Jerusalem, made repairs. People who've gotten used to the old way things were will be newly inspired when they start to see something happening. Look what happens. This is an official of the half district of Jerusalem. This guy was the official of the half district of Jerusalem, and Jerusalem didn't have a wall. So why did he start building? Because even though he already had the job, he got up and got going when he started to see things happening. Let me say it this way. People don't understand this is how it works. Get into a church. Don't change everything. Start getting something going. When people can get on board with what's going on, they'll change. And don't walk in and go, I want to change how we're doing everything. Walk in and start doing something they can get behind. And when they get behind it, they'll follow you. Then when you make changes, they won't jump ship. Okay? In a very real way, when I came with an objective to do one thing. You're part of it. That's what I was here to do. We had a pastor. He quit. That's how I got the job. The reality is that's not what I came to do. I came here to do this. I moved from Jerusalem to do this. But people got on board with it, and they love you. They think you're the best thing ever. So they come to church all excited about what you're learning. You have no idea. 80% of the people that stop me want to know what we're doing at GCBI. It's almost like we're like a thing for them. Okay? Here's the truth. They're on board with what the church is doing because they're on board with what you're doing. They saw something happening, and now they want to get behind it. I really like the way he did this. I also want you to understand something. Go down to verse 8 because I skipped it. The team is made up of people who show up and work. Not the people who think that they should have a voice in everything because they have a knowledge in that area. Oh boy, that was tough. Stop. The team's made up of the workers, not the people with opinions, the workers. You want me to listen to your opinion about something? Show that you're working at it. Otherwise, your insights are less valuable to me when you're not a worker. Okay? So where did I get that? Look at verse 8. Next to him, Uziel, the son of Harhiah, of the goldsmiths, made repairs. I underlined goldsmiths. And next to him, Hananiah, one of the perfumers, made repairs. And I underlined perfumers. And they restored Jerusalem as far as the broad wall. Now drop down to verse 10. Next to them, Yediah, the son of Harumaf, made repairs opposite his house. And next to him, Hattush, the son of Hash. Abinah made repairs. Malkiah, the son of Harim, the son of Hashhuv, the son of Pachat Moab, repaired another section of the Tower of Furnaces. Next to him, Shalom, the son of Halochesh, the official of half of the district of Jerusalem, made repairs. Now underline this. He and his daughters. I love this. Hanun and the inhabitants of Zanoah repaired the valley gate. They built it and hung its doors with its bolts and its bars and 1,000 cubits of the wall to the refuse gate. Here's what I found interesting. Look at that section closely. The work was being done by those who showed up. It didn't matter what class of people they were or how they worked. It included priests, goldsmiths, perfumers in the district, rulers, and their daughters. If you keep reading, you catch a glimpse of some Levites in verse 17 and some shopkeepers in verse 32. Do you think it mattered that the perfumers didn't know how to build walls or the goldsmiths weren't particularly good at architecture? Not really. They were people who were ready to be led, instructed, and checked. And that's what makes a good team. Do not assume that because the team shows up and they don't all have expertise in this, you can't build a good team. Ministry is done by those who show up. Work is done by those who show up. And sometimes they're not the best and they're not the ones you would have asked for an architect's convention. He didn't have an architect's convention, so he built with what he had. We don't have time to look at everything this passage offers, but I can say a few quick sentences about the rest of it. Look at verse 14. I see someone got the refuse gate. That's the dung gate today. We call it the dung gate today. What does that tell you? Well, some people are going to work on the parts that are more pungent because some of the essential parts aren't the pretty ones. I would make a note next to 14. Some of the essential parts aren't the pretty ones. Everybody wants to work on the pretty parts. Nobody's necessarily wanting to work on the refuse gate, except for when your chamber pot's full, you're going to really wish that somebody had a gate there. Because if you have to walk the long way around with a full chamber pot, that ain't nice. How about this? Verse 10 and verse 23, both of them. I spotted a few guys who, it has this little phrase, they only repaired the part next to their own house. Did you see that in verse 10 and verse 23? Next to their house. You know what I made note of? Don't assume that because somebody does a great deal of work, they did it for the right reasons. Some people showed up, but they actually have their own agenda. They'll build as long as it's on their house, as long as it helps them. There are going to be people that show up every Sunday morning as long as they're getting business out of it. They're going to show up and they're going to sing as long as they get to choose the songs because they got a personal angle in what they're doing. Assume that in every great people work group, there's going to be somebody out there who does it for their own benefit. Look at verse 20. Count on God to supply some people who do it with such fervency that their heart is stirred. Look at verse 20. After him, Baruch, the son of Zabai, zealously repaired. Oh, mark that one. He did it with gusto, zealously repaired another section from the angle to the doorway of the house of Eliashiv, the high priest. Baruch means blessing. And a guy by the name of Blessing lived up to his name. He didn't just work, he worked zealously. The Hebrew word charal, zealously, is with heat or with great anger or great fervor. This guy chucked rocks like you can't believe. He was... He's doing it, man. Here's the thing. I want you to remember something. He's in the eternal record of God as having worked incredibly hard. Do not think it escapes God when you do it well. Do not think it escapes God when you do it when you're exhausted and when you're physically empty. I'm just going to close this by saying this. I mean this from my heart. You will have no idea the number of times I got up to speak on a Sunday morning absolutely empty emotionally because of something that happened that week or something that was going on. It's not about you and it's not about me. The story is about Jesus. You get up and you do your job, whether you feel like doing it or not. You do your job. And the thing is, at the end of the day, Jesus knows you did your job. Do it with gusto. Put the most into it. I promise you that when you are at your lowest, I start setting myself on fire up here. The reason is it's the only way I can hold your attention. If I get loud, it's because you got quiet. If I start moving around and acting like a wild man, it's because you are falling asleep. I do the same thing Sunday morning. I do the same thing Sunday night. You have to. Look, kids watch whatever's moving in the room. I watch Malachi, and he watches whatever's moving in the room. Okay? Slow it down, get boring, you'll lose him. You pour it on when you're absolutely exhausted, but God notices. Okay? You don't do it for the room. You do it for him. I love that that guy did it zealously. I just think, I don't know what whipping rocks into place on a wall zealously looks like, but whatever it was, everybody got to know that he's the guy who did it with zeal. I'll bet you he did it with a few pinched fingers, too, because you don't move heavy rocks without pinching your fingers if you're doing it zealously, okay? I think that there were other guys who were going, oh, come on, let's knock it off for a lunch break. Just 20 more rocks, 20 more rocks, 30 more rocks. We can do it. Come on. I think he was out there cheerleading that whole section. And I think that all it takes is one person totally dedicated to doing it to get everybody else fired up to hang in there. Haven't you ever done this? You were out there and you were doing a project and somebody who was enthusiastic got you to hang in there about twice as long as you would have. Okay? There's always that one zealous guy. Okay.